Hi, I'm Dave Brown. I'm going to show you how to catch loads of lovely F1s like this on Caster Shallow. I absolutely love when summertime comes along because it means I can get my shallow rigs out, pick up my catapult and feed loads of casters and catch them lovely F1 shallow. Thing I like about casters is you can be quite aggressive with the feed. Everything eats casters, which creates a lot of competition in your peg. And then once them F1s turn on, nothing else is going to get a look in. I prefer feeding casters over pellets because it creates more competition in your peg because everything will eat a caster. Whereas with pellets, you limit yourself to a certain few species. You create that competition, and then once the F1s and carp turn up, nothing else is going to get a look in. There's no getting away from the fact that casters aren't cheap. So it's important to, when you buy your casters, when you finish your session, is look after your casters in between your sessions. So I put mine into, it's quite a thick black bag. Take all the air out. Tighten the bag down and put it in the fridge, and they'll last in there for 3 to 4 weeks, no problem at all. And then when I'm out on the match, sometimes somebody will throw the casters away, I'll have those casters off them, and because I'll look after them. It isn't a cheap way of fishing, but you can help yourself by looking after your casters and scrounging a few old ones. Don't worry if your casters don't look pristine, because they haven't really got to be. As long as you've looked after them, they don't float. Doesn't matter if they smell, doesn't matter if they're dark, as long as they sink, the fish will eat them. One of the important factors about caster shallow fishing is you've got to prime the swim before you actually fishy. So start somewhere else in your peg, either on the feeder or start short. Just start somewhere else in your peg, but just make sure you're always using a catapult and putting casters in your peg. It's one of those methods that will get progressively better as the match or the session goes on, and towards the end, it can be absolutely brilliant. How much to feed all depends on how your session's going. Sometimes it can take a lot of casters to actually get your peg going, a point, maybe 2 points, to get it going. But then once it's going and you're catching well, you tend to back off your feed and not feed so many. You need to take 3 to 5 points with you. Some sessions you'll use the 5 points, some times you'll only use 2. And that's when you take them home and stick them back in the fridge in your black bag. Deciding where to fish caster shallow in your peg can sometimes be dictated to you by the anglers around you and how far out they are fishing. If they're fishing 13, 14 and a half metres, you've got to go that distance as well, else they'll take fish from you. But if nobody around you is doing it, you can catch them on short lines, short top 2 and 2 lines. I'll only feed long if others around me are doing that. Also, if there's cover in your peg, like reed beds to the far bank or deep water where it's got some cover, you'll catch on any of these lines. It's just a bit of watercraft and experience will determine where you're catching your peg. As you can see, I've got a selection of top kits here with rigs already attached. These always stay on these kits and in the top kit case. The reason I've got so many varied lengths is because sometimes the fish will come up, they'll go down, and I want a short lash between the pole tip and the float, because sometimes they can hook themselves. It just adds to better presentation. One thing you'll notice about all these top kits is the length of line between the float and the pole tip is very similar, which is creating that short lash. Now, the difference between the rigs is the length of line below the float to the hook. So if I'm missing bites, I'll pick up a shorter rig because the fish are obviously higher than what my hook bait is sitting. In my opinion, you can't beat fishing with a short kit when you're shallow fishing for F1s. And then combined with DuraSlip 11 elastic, I don't think there's a better combination. I actually get 2 top kits out of 1 packet, so open the packet and then cut it in half, and that will do 2 top kits. One of the best tips I can give you for caster shallow fishing is to band your caster. Now for this I use the medium band, on a size 18 GPMB. You look for the pointy end of your caster and just push it through like so. Now the reason I use banded caster is because I can now slap that rig around on the surface and I will not burst that caster. Whereas if I hook the caster, it probably lasts two slaps before it's just a complete mess and the caster's gone. So that is one of your biggest tips for caster shallow fishing, is to band your caster. If you look in my hook length box, you'll find I've got varying size hook lengths, ranging from 4 inch, which is probably as long as I'll use, all the way down to a 2 inch. Now the 2 inch hook lengths I use on my really short shallow rigs, because sometimes you need to fish 8 inches deep. Now when you've got a 2-3 inch float on and a 4 inch hook length, that's obviously too long already. And plus you've got to get your shot on the rig. So a 2 inch hook length helps you to fish really short rigs so you can get really high up in the water. On the subject of hook lengths, my go-to hook for this type of fishing is a size 18 GPMB. Now I like these hooks because they stay sharp all day. That is a really important factor of this type of fishing, because essentially a lot of the time you're looking for the fish to hook themselves. If you've got a blunt hook, they ain't going to do that. Noise is another important thing with this type of fishing. Bringing the fish to your feed, making that noise. You'll get a noise off the bait that you're feeding, whether it be casters or pellets. You can also slap your pole and tap the tip of your pole, which creates that bit more noise, but it also fools the fish into thinking that a feed's got him. But when they actually get to it, there's just your hook bait there for him to eat. There's no getting away from the fact that this is a busy method. You've always got to have your catapult in your hand pretty much. When you're playing a fish, you're feeding. When you're landing a fish, you're feeding. When you're shipping out, you're feeding. It's a really busy method. To keep those fish up in the little pelagos, you've got to be busy with your catapult. But there's two main types of floats I use for shallow fishing, and it'll be the F1 shallow if I'm fishing anywhere over 12 inches up to 3 foot, say, and then anything below 12 inches, I'll use the dibber in a 4x10. The dibber, I tend to be fishing that with the bulk, but then the F1 shallow, it depends on how the fish are having it as to how I fish it. I shot it. Sometimes the shot will all be under the float with one dropper, and other times, if I've got the depth right, I'll have a bulk above the hook length. All depends on how the session's going. An important thing about whatever float you're using is being able to read those floats. So if you're missing lots of bites fishing shallow, you're obviously fishing too deep and the fish are higher than your hook bait. So you need to either pick up a shorter rig or shallow up. And on the other end, if you're not getting any bites, you're not fishing deep enough.
So if you've enjoyed this video and want to see plenty more like this, don't forget to subscribe to the Preston Innovations YouTube channel. Completely free, and it's bound to put more fish in your net.